From the WLOE and WMYN News and Public Affairs Department, this is Community Accents, connecting Rockingham County people, businesses, and services, recorded live on location and broadcast Monday through Friday at 8:30 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. Video production funding provided by the Rockingham County Business and Technology Center. Entrepreneur focused, technology enabled, future driven.
Good morning and welcome to Community Accents. I'm Deputy Shane Woodall, SRO at McMichael High School. Coming to you today, I just want to talk to you a little bit about what's going on at McMichael High School. Starting today through October the 26th, we started a celebration kickoff here. It's called Celebrate My Drive Through State Farm. And what that is, our school is registered, and they'll be giving away, State Farm will be giving away two grand prize to the high school with the most votes. And what you do, you go online, and you can go online to celebratemydrive.com. And there's a couple steps you have to go through. And once you're there, you can vote for McMichael High School. And by voting for McMichael High School, it'll count the votes for our school. And once again, you know, there's going to be two grand prizes of $100,000. And then there's going to be 10 others for $100,000, along with 90 grants at $25,000 to our school. And basically what you do, you'll go on, you'll answer a couple questions, and that will vote for our school. I'm actually now joined by Lieutenant Jennifer Brame of the Rockingham County Sheriff's Office. She's the Lieutenant of the Civil Division. And we're going to talk to you also about, I was talking to him, Jennifer, about the Celebrate My Drive that we're starting today through October the 26th, and encouraging the citizens of this community to vote for McMichael High School. We have registered for these to get this grant, and every vote counts. It's basically the way it's broken down is into large and small category high schools. And McMichael High School, being we have 1,000 students, we're actually considered a large high school. And there's some schools across the United States, you know, can be in Texas, that would have a lot more students than us. So we're asking the community's help to vote for McMichael High School till we can receive this grant for $100,000.
I think it's a wonderful idea and a wonderful program, and we'd like to encourage everyone listening to please vote for McMichael. They've got some really good ideas, and they're trying to accomplish something really important here, and I think it would mean a lot if the community would rally together and support McMichael.
And I think with this grant, I've talked to our principal, Lee Jones. The money, you don't have to use it for any particular thing, but I was talking to her actually the other day, and we were talking about maybe using it for more video cameras at the school, for school security, and actually to help promote events at our school.
Okay, we're talking about school security and how important it is, whether, once again, whether it's our high schools, our elementary, or our middle schools. And school security is paramount, with Sheriff Page taking care of the kids, making sure they are safe at all times. So I think that's a really good idea that Principal Jones has with using those funding. That'd be great.
And also, we school system, actually our school has a, we've just actually got some flyers printed for us. It's actually put on through our Phoenix Flames, which is our school newspaper. It's saying no to harassment, teasing, and bullying. And these items are placed, the flyers are placed all throughout the school. They're placed in, going into the restroom, you know, going at lunch. And basically what it is, it's just, it's two different flyers, and one of them says, what is harassment? And, you know, the one bullet point on it says, tell the person to stop. Speak clearly. Say it loud enough for the other person to hear, to leave you alone, to stop harassing you and stop bothering you. Also, you know, if it continues to report, I mean, to happen, you need to continue to report it. You know, tell the truth to your teacher, mm-hmm. to your counselor, your school resource officer, or another school personnel. You know, and school staff, the administration will talk to the aggressor. You know, we have a zero tolerance to bullying and harassment, whether it's, you know, verbal or through Facebook and Twitter. We're having a lot of that going on at the schools now with, you know, well, not schools, but just throughout, just with young adults on social media.
And that's a shame, too. And we might want to talk a little bit about exactly what harassment is, because a lot of people hear about harassment and may not think about what they're doing as being harassment. But I notice here that you have a really good definition of what harassment is, if you want to share that with us as well.
Harassment is basically any form of unwanted, deliberate, or offensive behavior that someone is asking the other one to stop.
Okay. That's good. And your staff, your teachers, your principal is on board with this and supports?
Yeah, yes, ma'am. We have a zero tolerance. And, you know, there are laws, cyberbullying law, and there's a cyber stalking law. You know, the repeated harassment, like cyber stalking over, you know, a fax machine, telephone, social media. You know, it's a chargeable offense in the school system.
I think a lot of people are really unclear on what really constitutes bullying. Sometimes they think they're being funny or it's just a joke, but they don't realize what it's doing to the other person. So I think it's great that you have this in the schools where you can explain and you give kids an opportunity to tell what's happening to them.
You know, we have different programs. You know, I try to teach all of the ninth graders, because all the ninth graders have to come through a health class. And by coming through the health class, there's a program, it's called Think Before You Click. And basically, you know, kids can express themselves, but a lot of times they like to express it over social media. And sometimes they really don't know hurtful things that could come across. You know, they may not think that it's hurtful, but we know when you click the button to send it, you know, it's out there. You can't resend it. And it can be hurtful depending on how the other person will take it.
That's exactly right. What are some other things that your school is doing to promote students or promote their well-being?
We are partnering with the Highway Patrol to do a texting simulation. What they do, the Trooper Elrod, Mike Elrod, is assigned to McMichael High School. And what we do is we bring golf carts to the school, and we set out cones, and we simulate a texting and driving. We'll have a particular student or staff that we have two separate phones, and we'll try to have a kid to interact when they're texting and they're going through different obstacles with cones. It's in a blocked off part of the school.
That's really great too. And I know the Highway Patrol is really good about, you know, getting that out there and promoting that. And, you know, they care a lot about the kids too, as well as the sheriff's office.
They do. And we actually, we had ours was rained out back in the first of this month. We're going to try to reschedule for sometime in November. We're going to try to get it done maybe before the kids go on Thanksgiving break. And we're also going to do another one in the spring. We're going to actually put the fatal vision goggles on that simulates driving while impaired. And we'll have them come out, and we'll probably do that before the prom promise. Mm-hmm. A prom is in May, and we'll usually do that before the prom to make the kids aware of, you know, the dangers of drinking and driving. And we'll probably will maybe do the texting again with them to kind of throw a little bit of that back to them to let them know the dangers of that.
Right. And those fatal vision glasses, a lot of people aren't familiar with those. It's a really cool concept that you can use to teach kids about what it's like to be impaired, whether it might be from marijuana or alcohol or some type of prescription drugs. There are different glasses, am I right?
They're different, like a point. There's some that are 0.08. We have some that are 0.16, which would be twice the legal limit of impairment.
Okay. What kind of reaction did you have from the kids last year, the last time the Highway Patrol came up and you did that? Was it a positive?
They really enjoyed it. They actually wanted it back. Actually, last year we'd done all of the PE classes, so we actually had some ninth graders that were, you know, some of them that were starting driver's ed, and, you know, and I they didn't realize, you know, they've always heard it, but, you know, I had a couple students to say, you know, that really impacted me, you know, but texting and driving, didn't realize how dangerous it was, because we compared them, the texting with the DWI goggles and the distraction, you know, looking down and running off, you know, hitting these cones, you know, they actually thought it was funny. But then once the Highway Patrol gave their message, and then they have a video message that we go inside and look at it kind of really hits home to some of the kids.
It becomes reality then. They realize that it's not all fun and games and the seriousness of it.
And also through the county, there's a program it's put on through, it's called VIP for VIP. Mm-hmm. It's Vehicle Injury Prevention for a Very Important Person. This program is free to the schools. You contact, they're out of High Point. They have a Facebook page, VIP for VIP. And what they do is they come to your school. Usually, you know, some of them are doing it now because they're booked because everybody wants to have these people come. And what it is, you have a morning presentation that's in your gymnasium auditorium. And basically, you have different fire personnel, EMS personnel, mm-hmm. highway patrol, and any of your resource officers will talk about firsthand things that they have witnessed, you know, dealing with tragic deaths and motor vehicle accident. You know, one thing that hits close to home, the highway patrol, you know, they give their speak, they're talking about that knock on the door that they have to give to parents, you know, that's the, you know, 5 o'clock in the morning, you know, having to give that knock on the door. So it's just, it can be heart wrenching to see two state troopers at your door. And also, you know, that you break for lunch, then the afternoon portion is actually it's a reconstructed accident. Mm-hmm. Basically what it is would be like a jogger would come up and they would come upon a wreck. And this individual that's playing the driver is actually, he's deceased, but it's like he's talking to the medical people. Hey, I need to get to my mom. Why are you doing mm-hmm. this to me? And, you know, and we've had that two different occasions at our school, and it's really, you know, and I've seen kids in the audience that tear up, mm-hmm. you know, and that to me that lets know that, hey, this is hitting close to home for these children.
It's very emotional. I was fortunate enough to come and watch mm-hmm. some of it at the schools, and it sends a very strong message. I think it's important that students see this. I think it's wonderful that we have the officers that come together and do that. The group out of High Point, you know, it's amazing. We didn't have something like that when, you know, back when we were in yeah. school. And I think we've come a long way with technology and the things that we can offer. I know times have changed, and we didn't have the Facebook and all the electronic means of communication back then as much as we do now. So I think it's important that kids realize the dangers and what can happen by some, you know, choices that we make. And a lot of them, you know, aren't the best choices in the world, and they can have some negative consequences. So I think it's wonderful that law enforcement can be involved with this in trying to reach out and save the kids and make an impact on them.
I think a good thing is just, it's always educating. I don't think you cannot educate the children enough to let them know the dangers of drinking and driving, consequences they make, you know, the consequences that can come about when you have passengers in their cars, you know, driving along these roads and highways of Rockingham County or, you know, out of the county, you know, the danger. And I think these programs, you know, help these children out to make better decisions.
I agree with you. And I know Sheriff Page is a big supporter of that. And I don't know if you've already mentioned he wanted to be here this morning, but he could not. He is, in fact, reading to the children at Tuttle's Farm. And he enjoys that aspect of it. So he does send his regrets that he's not with us today.
At this time, we will take a brief break, and we'll be back to you in a few minutes.
Video production funding provided by the Rockingham County Business and Technology Center. Entrepreneur-focused, technology-enabled, future-driven. Visit our website for additional information, rockinghambusiness.org.
WLOE Eden. WMYN Mandan. Listen online all the time. RockinghamCountyRadio.com.
Okay, welcome back. I'm here with Deputy Shane Woodall. I'm Lieutenant Jennifer Brame with the Rockingham County Sheriff's Office. We're talking a little bit this morning about the role of a school resource officer. And we've talked about some wonderful programs that McMichael High School has going on, taking care of their students and some things that they're accomplishing and trying to get done there. But right now, I just want to take a few minutes that we can explain maybe what a school resource officer is. We are fortunate enough in Rockingham County to have, or for the Sheriff's Office, to have three school resource officers. Deputy Woodall here is assigned to McMichael High School. We also have Deputy Scott Woody assigned to Rockingham County Senior High and Deputy Shane Bullins at Rockingham County Middle School. And I'm going to let Shane tell you a little bit about what a school resource officer does and what his role is in the school.
The school resource officer basically has three roles. They're a law enforcement officer, law-related counselor, and law-related educator. And as far as the bullet point as a law enforcement officer, you know, we assist the school administration, whatever needs they may come about, you know, trying to maintain a safe and secure environment at the school. There may be times that, you know, arrests have to be made for various crimes that are committed. That's one of the main things is I want to be a positive, and I think what the Rockingham County Sheriff's Office and what the sheriff and all stresses about SROs is being a positive role model for children.
That's right, and all three of you, you know, you really are. I've seen all of you in action. They're good guys. They really are. They care about their schools. They care about the students, and, you know, they want to do what's best for them.
And also, as far as a law-related counselor, you know, we assist. We have a through our guidance department is that handle conflict resolutions. A lot of times, you know, if you have a conflict with two individuals are having a conflict, you will set them down, and we have peer mediation that we help. We will assign children that they've been through peer mediation training, that they sit down and they will try to solve these problems between the two individuals that are having a problem. And I think that heads off a lot of conflict, especially when you're assisting another young adult in having them to sit down and iron their differences out. Also, far as the counselor, you know, there may be family problems at home that you have to assist with, contacting DSS if they need to get involved in something.
That's right. Now, you have counselors on school staff as well. Are there counselors there?
We do. We have four in our guidance department, three guidance counselors and a secretary. And it's basically broken down into grade level and alphabet.
Okay. That's another good resource for you.
And the third point, law-related educator. You know, as I was saying before, we go into the classrooms and when we talk to kids, especially ninth graders, you're coming into high school, it's a big change coming from middle school, and try to acclimate them into the high school role and educate them, you know, like the think before you click that we do all to the ninth graders. And, you know, just being out, you know, every year when we start, myself and Ms. Jones, which is the principal at McMichael, we sit down with each grade level, and she talks about and I talk about what the expectations of us at the school and as a law enforcement officer there at McMichael High School.
Good. And with this, the role of the SRO, that is with the officer at Rockingham High School and middle school. They follow these guidelines as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you had to go through some special training. You just didn't come to work one day, and we sent you to McMichael High School and just kind of threw you out there. Can you tell us a little bit about what you had to go through to become an SRO?
I went through a basic SRO school in Salemburg at the Justice Academy. It was a week-long school. It's a 40-hour school that they you know, told us, you know, the ins and outs of being an SRO. And I remember the last part of that as I had to create a plan of what I was going to speak about to give a presentation. I was really nervous having to do that, but now talking with kids, it's just like walking, you know. And anytime you can educate an individual, a young child to do the right thing, make good choices, you know, that means a lot. And to see a lot of these kids, you know, I may go out in the community and see them, and they remember me. You know, and I've had parents to, you know, to think, and that really makes you feel good about yourself that you may have made an impact on a young person's life.
Definitely. And I know it's a learning experience all the time. I mean, you learn on the job.
Every day.
You never know what's going to happen. You go in there and you talk to the kids, you talk to the staff, and you learn from each other, basically.
Mm-hmm.
I know that you have some other resources that, you know, other than the training that you went to. Are there any other resources that you have in the community that kind of work together to support the schools and help you? I know the Juvenile Justice Office is a good contact.
Yeah, the Juvenile Court Authority is in Wentworth. You know, we work along. We actually have, programs, you know, for teen court, you know, through the youth services. And you actually can get, you know, counseling. We have counseling services through youth services that they can be, you know, referred to. And it doesn't have to be, you know, if a child's misbehaving. It can be for family, you know, family problems or whatever they're, you know, expressing the problem. They can actually help them.
You know, a lot of people, you just said something about teen court. A lot of people in the county may not be familiar with exactly what teen court is. It's an opportunity, from what I understand, for kids to that have gotten into some kind of trouble to try to resolve that before they get into the actual court system. Can you tell us a little bit about how teen court works?
Teen court, Phil McFall is the coordinator for teen court. And what teen court is, it happens on every second Monday of every month at our courthouse at 6 o'clock. And basically, teen court is for someone, an individual that has been in trouble in school mm-hmm. for a misdemeanor in school. And it's kind of a way Mr. McFall, I've heard him in his presentation, like a get out of jail free card. You don't mean you're going to go to jail, but what it is, you go to teen court, it's a $25 fee. And teen court is put on why it's called teen court is by your peers. The jury is your peers. Mm-hmm. The bailiff, the attorney, the prosecuting attorney. And basically the good thing about teen court, you have to admit guilt. It's a $25 fee and it does not go on your record. Whether you're, 16 years old, if whatever you get sent to teen court, that does not go on your record. That's what's a good thing. And the recidivism for teen court is very high. A lot of kids that go through it do not come back. It's in the 90 percentile. The kids do not get back in trouble, because once they get back into trouble, you cannot go to teen court but one time, and you have to have a clean record before you can go.
So this is all peer related, the judge and everything. Now, is there a judge, but the bailiff and is there a jury?
The jury, and what they have two different pools. They have a pool A and a pool B. Pool A could be maybe Moorhead and McMichael students, and they'll hear a case from a Rockingham and Reason. You don't want the same kids peers. Hearing something gotcha. That would be from their own school.
Makes sense.
And it can vary. Let's say, for instance, disorderly conduct. They may have to do 8 or 10 hours of community service, mm-hmm. write a letter of an apology to whoever, the school or the other person it was disorderly to. And then they have to come back and do one jury duty. And a lot of times there's been kids that's come through and have, I call it a bump in the road. They've had to go to teen court and they actually like the concept, and they've actually become volunteers. Whether it's 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th grade, if you're just doing it for 1 year, that's actually on your transcript when you decide to move on in life.
That's a great experience. Now, is there an age limit that for somebody who can go to teen court?
The age you cannot turn 19 by the time you go to teen court. Most high school seniors are around 18 years old. Okay. That program is really good. I really enjoy. Actually, myself, Deputy Bullens, and Deputy Woody, we all rotate, mm-hmm. Being there to kind of assist if anything Mr. McFall needs anything. And also, if let's say they've been caught, a larceny in the school, mm-hmm. There's a shoplifting seminar that I actually put on. And what it is, when they come back, we'll do a shoplifting seminar and explains the, just why prices go up on food at Walmart, because people have stole stuff, and then that makes the price of what we have to pay go up.
So it's an educational aspect to it as well. Mm-hmm. I think it's awesome that we have that in the county, and when you have students who make some mistakes, maybe they made a bad choice, they have this option to maybe, like you said, get them back on the right track.
I've had one of them, and I think out of all the being a jury, the one that actually is like the prosecutor, mm-hmm. the basic what is they read off what happened, and I've had one that's come through and actually they've graduated, and they have become the lawyer, the prosecutor in the courtroom setting, and they really loved it. And I remember he told me it was funny. He said that it took him getting in trouble to realize what he liked to do, but I said that wasn't really the best thing to do, but he's graduated from college and he's successful.
That's great. We like to hear those success stories. Now, I know you may have some other questions. We've not covered everything, but we do have a website, the Sheriff's Office website, www.rockinghamsheriff.com. You can actually go on there, and there are sections with divisions, and the school resource officers do have a division. If you click on that, you can go to specifically to them, and it'll show you your email address. So mm-hmm. if you have any questions or concerns or anything like that, you can actually contact our school resource officers directly, as well as my email address. I'm the lieutenant over the civil division, which does supervise the school resource officers, as well as our civil division officers and our records division officers. So if you ever have questions or concerns, feel free to give us a call, email us. With the technology today, there's all kinds of ways to get in touch with us. But we feel like the students, the kids in Rockingham County are so very important. The sheriff believes in it. He is concerned about school safety. He wants to keep our kids safe. He's always been that way since he came into office in 1998. It's always been important to him.
Yeah, what I like is, the sheriff will pop in and have lunch, and the kids really, warm up to him. They come over and ask him questions. The sheriff always is answering questions. Mm-hmm. And, I think it means a lot when the sheriff will come into the school, comes into the schools and sits down with the kids and the staff and have lunch with them. And, he answers any questions that they have. I want to say one more thing. We have our football team, getting off the subject. Our football team, like they said, the game of the week tonight at Moorhead High School at 7:30. Next week, October the 25th is McMichael's homecoming.
Okay.
It'll be our homecoming. And then 2 weeks after that, November the 8th, it will be our senior night. We kind of encourage everybody to come out and to support not just McMichael High School, but support all the local football. Football's winding down, and then basketball will pick up. And I just think when the community comes out and supports, it means a lot to the kids on the field.
Definitely, it does.
And we want to thank you for being here. Myself and Lieutenant Brame and Rockingham County Sheriff's Office, we want to thank you and see you next time.
Thanks.